Hello, and thank you for coming to our lightning talk today. Our lightning talk is, Are You Still Watching? Developing an On-Demand Library Workshop Service. And this was created by myself, Michael Myers, and my colleague, Katie Merriman. So just a little bit about us before we get into our lightning talk. My name is Michael Myers, and I'm an information specialist at Unity Health Toronto Library Services. And I mainly specialize in the management of electronic resources. Katie, you can introduce yourself now.
Thank you, Michael. Hello, my name is Katie Merriman. I am also an information specialist and I primarily work with marketing and outreach. With that, let's get started, Michael.
Yes. So last year, Katie and I had the privilege of presenting on how Unity Health Toronto Library Services made the switch from in-person instruction to online during the pandemic. And in this presentation, we mentioned that we'd be launching an on-demand library workshop service. This new service was designed to be a catalog of asynchronous learning videos that patrons could view at their own time and pace. This service was modeled after the library's Excel eLearning module, which was launched in 2020 and consisted of 14 short Excel learning videos in lieu of an in-person offering of Excel instructional sessions. By recording our instructional sessions without audiences, we were able to compile a catalog of asynchronous learning library videos that were organized into the on-demand workshop service. The on-demand workshop service lives on the St. Michael's Library website under workshops, and each class has an embedded video of the recording, which is hosted on the library's YouTube account. In addition to the embedded videos, each class also has the course description listed, the learning objectives, the slides, a help button, and the approximate length of the class. We also have every on-demand recording and Excel e-learning video listed in Unity Health Toronto's learning management system to ensure that these videos have multiple access points and are a part of the institutional's professional development opportunities. So here's an example of what I was talking about. You can see this is the library workshops page on the St. Michael's Library website. And we have a page for on-demand workshops. And this is the homepage. It tells the patrons what the service is, all the classes that are offered, and you can see the new ones that are recently added to the on-demand workshop service with the red new icon. But let's go to Medline Advanced for an example. As I mentioned, here is the embedded video that's hosted on YouTube, the course description with the approximate length, the course objectives, the slides, as well as some other resources, and the feedback button here at the bottom. So now I'll hand it over to Katie, who will talk about how we created the on-demand workshop service.
Thank you so much, Michael. All right, everyone, let's move on to how we did it. All right, so in total, this endeavor took about 3 months to complete. Keep in mind that all of our courses and instructional sessions had already been created. We didn't create any new content for this on-demand sessions. We just let our instructors determine what alterations might suit this new static medium. So we ended up dividing up all of our instructional sessions, allowing our instructors to choose which were the most, which sessions they were the most confident in presenting. And we asked everyone to record their own sessions on Zoom and then save the recorded files into one shared folder. Once they had finished the recording, they would then let me know what key points needed to be edited. I would then edit all the files in a very simple video editor. Generally, the video editing would entail cutting off just a little bit of the beginning, a little bit of the end, and a few speaking mistakes here and there. Once the video was edited, I'd then upload it to YouTube, and then I would send it over to Michael or one of our other colleagues, Chi, to embed it on the website. So really quite a simple process. I think that when we first began this project, and I think that to an outside perspective, this kind of project can seem really intimidating, but I think it went a lot easier and a bit more smoothly than we really anticipated. And with that, I'm going to pass you back to Michael.
Thanks, Katie. So I'm going to talk about how we measured success for this project. An important part of any project is measuring success to ensure that the project is meeting the needs of the patrons. And there are two main ways that we measured the success of this initiative. Firstly, we looked at stats. So we looked a lot at the web traffic for each on-demand class webpage, which has been presented on the slide here, with the most popular classes listed in the first graph and the newer classes in the second graph. As you can see, we have 7 on-demand classes that have seen over 100 hits. In addition to web traffic, we have also looked at the view counts on YouTube, which have seen similar numbers to the web page hits presented here. However, our advanced PowerPoint and presentation skills video has been viewed 465 times, and our gray literature searching class has been viewed 159 times. This demonstrates that our on-demand workshop videos are being used and shared outside of the web pages, which is very encouraging. In addition to the quantitative feedback that is presented through these stats, the Health Science Library has received many pieces of qualitative feedback from our users on how they appreciate having the ability to view these instructional sessions at their own time and pace. It has been especially expressed that users appreciate having the ability to sit in a live class with the instructor, then review the content in class again afterwards to solidify the learning objectives. So through these qualitative and quantitative stats, we are really able to measure the success of this initiative. Related to measuring success, it is also important to include an opportunity for users to provide feedback on the on-demand workshop service and ask any questions they might have while watching the videos. As mentioned before, this is accomplished by including feedback buttons on every on-demand page. And when the users click the button, a pop-up window will appear where they can ask their question or provide feedback on the video. So just as a quick demonstration, if we click this button here, we can see on the Advanced Medline class, this is the feedback button. And if we click it, a pop-up window appears where you can ask your question or provide feedback on the video. And you can also say that you would like to be responded to directly about the feedback or question. So that is how we've been measuring success and also been building in feedback opportunities. So now I'm going to hand it over back to Katie to talk about our next steps.
Thank you, Michael. All right, so let's talk about some next steps and some reflections. First, we're going to be talking about some learning curves. So I think one of the main learning curves that we had to overcome was Zoom confidence. Teaching can be hard in general, but having that element of recording can make it even more difficult for some. Recording allows for a different kind of self-scrutiny that you really can't do when you're teaching live. So it did take some time for us all to become confident. In addition, I had never really edited before, and I never used the editing platform that we used before. So it definitely took a little bit to learn and to feel confident learning how to use those materials. To continue, privacy. When you work in a hospital library, privacy is always of utmost importance. So you really had to be thoughtful and cautious that all of the data and the information being shared was okay with being shared. There was no private information, and made sure that IT was happy. And with that, let's move to the next slide. Thank you, Michael. So expanding the catalog, what's next for us is we're really interested in all of our new classes being recorded so that they can be added to our on-demand catalog. In addition to that, we're looking to re-record some of our older videos. I think all of our instructors would agree that they've all become a lot more confident in recording themselves, presenting and teaching, and that I think that some of the older courses can really do with some updating with some more Zoom confidence now. And moving on to our last slide, which is about accessibility. So this whole project has really been a huge bonus in our accessibility, but of course there's always progress to be made. So first of all, one of the main things about this new initiative is that now our workshops are available 24/7. So clinical staff who might not work typical 9-to-5 hours are now able to attend the workshops virtually, and people can watch it whenever it's available to them. In addition to that, people can take the videos at their own pace. They can pause, they can press play, they can watch half now, half later. They can re-record or back up a little bit so they can hear something being said twice. Really, they're allowed now to be able to take the class at a much more self-constructed pace. In addition, we have the option of closed captioning. So this can be really beneficial to our hearing impaired patrons. In addition, we have an accessibility audit where we had one of the students from the iSchool come in who has a background in working with those who have visual impairments to provide an audit and provide suggestions on how we can improve our accessibility. Always looking to make new steps forward in that regard. And with that, that is the end of our lightning talk. So thank you all so much for joining us today. Please feel free to contact us if you have any questions.
Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Heather McTavish, and I'm a librarian at Ontario Tech and Durham College. Prior to my role here, I pursued an MA in education with a focus on online learning and academic libraries. My showcase, therefore, is a little different than many of those I've seen in past showcases at the eLearning and Libraries Symposium, in that it's focused on research conducted as part of my thesis rather than within my own practice as a librarian. It wasn't until September that I started my academic librarian career. And so I'm hoping to continue researching in this area, and I welcome new connections and collaborations. In early 2019, I set out to learn about Canadian academic librarians' roles in online learning, guided by these questions. What online roles do academic librarians identify as having? What teaching and technology skills are required of their roles? And subsequently, how prepared do they feel for their roles in online learning environments? I sent out an online survey via the Canadian Association of Professional Academic Librarians and the eLearning and Libraries Collective listservs, asking about the online instructional practices of Canadian academic librarians. There were 45 participants from college and universities across six of the provinces, with the majority of respondents from comprehensive universities across Ontario and Alberta. And I imagine that if the same survey was to be sent out now, there would be many more participants having been immersed in online roles, many of us, for the past year and a half. Librarians across many broad categories identified as having an online role, not just those with positions related to online learning or positions one might traditionally think of as having teaching responsibilities like instruction and reference librarians. Rather, online instructional roles were distributed across the profession in line with the findings of the literature review, which really focused on the teaching role of academic librarians and showed that the educational role is one that's growing across institutions. Librarians identified as educators working along a continuum from face-to-face to fully online, designing synchronous online sessions and asynchronous learning, including instructional videos to support blended and online learning, creating online learning modules, learning objects, and instructional tools, as well as delivering a range of teaching to students and sometimes to other librarians, as well as to faculty. This study also identified a new role which had not been previously reported in the literature on the teaching role of academic librarians. And in some cases, librarians are e-learning and educational technology leaders, as many of you are. And these librarians identified as having as early adopters, subject experts, institutional committee participants, and faculty developers and supporters, and are in some cases guiding e-learning initiatives not only at the library, but at their institutions. This shows the significant educational role of academic librarians in e-learning transitions. And then some with no role or little role, little involvement in online learning, were seeking ways to be involved at their institutions, suggesting that they recognize that educational role of academic librarians within online learning as one of importance. And surely they would have found those opportunities in the past year. Instruction occurs across environments. 42% of librarians reported working in all three types of learning environments, indicating a need for librarians to move seamlessly between face-to-face and online environments and to possess the requisite skills to be able to do that. That the majority of librarians report that their online instructional responsibilities were also increasing over time suggests this number will only grow, and it has. Who would have thought that 2020 would have increased this need exponentially? Online responsibilities increased due to teaching opportunities in areas that move beyond the library, such as librarians taking on educational roles in the Teaching and Learning Center, co-teaching a digital humanities course, or just becoming a primary instructor for a particular course, for example. And this is often due to personal initiative, recognizing the need to integrate more online learning at their libraries and provide students with more flexible learning and equal opportunity. But changes at the institutional level were also driving this increase, such as graduate students being involved in more online learning, with more faculties offering distance learning courses, which results in an increase in the demand for online learning support from the library. To give you an idea of how librarians identified using technology in their instructional practice and the depth of technological pedagogical knowledge required in instructional practice across the profession, I'm highlighting a couple of excerpts from a table in my thesis, which shows a broad range of technologies used in online instruction, including technology to deliver content, production tools, and web authoring tools. But we're just going to focus on tech to deliver content. So for example, 8 different learning management platforms were used to deliver instructional content with a wide range of participation across these platforms. Participation spans from managing entire courses to posting course materials, delivering lessons, to building and posting quizzes for student evaluation. Learning technologies such as Padlet, Google Docs, or Nearpod for collaborative activities, a variety of video conferencing tools to deliver webinars, connect with students and faculty remotely, and provide online instruction, as well as gamification software for student engagement and assessment were all identified. Despite this, the intersection of technology and pedagogy as part of our online roles, the majority of librarians felt unprepared to teach early in their positions, let alone to be able to translate that teaching ability to online environments. Generally, they learned to teach while on the job rather than during their librarian education, which I'm sure has been many of your experiences as well. Therefore, they do not necessarily possess that foundational pedagogical knowledge to be able to translate to the online learning environments. And then most identified learning how to teach during their current role, a former role, or through practice related to through practice or through work-related professional development. This unpreparedness translates to librarians seeking all sorts of learning opportunities related to teaching and technology, which really can be used to inform the preparation of future librarians taking on these roles. Under teaching training, librarians identify learning in the areas of foundational knowledge and instructional design, which includes an understanding of learning theories and instructional strategies for the adult learner, as well as how to create learning outcomes and align those outcomes with specific tasks. Knowledge of participatory or active learning strategies and how to assess learning were also identified. Additionally, specific technologies were identified, indicating that keeping up with tools to support online learning is important, as we all know. Overall, the main two areas that librarians recommended for future librarians taking up similar roles are within education and technology. From this research, I developed a competency framework that builds on Stephen Bell and John Shank's 2004 concept of the blended librarian and then Tony Bates' 2014 continuum of technology-based learning. It identifies the need for blended skills sets to work across varied learning environments seamlessly, and it also shows those varied instructional modes librarians are tasked to design for and teach within at any given time, hence the circles moving around. What might this translate into in terms of educating future librarians online? Well, one recommendation is to build instructional curriculum into the professional education of future librarians, which considers the online role. This would incorporate teaching and learning theory, instructional design, and educational technologies, along with the traditional information literacy instruction that librarians are sometimes exposed to. So going more in depth, this learning should include the opportunity to work within varied learning environments that expose librarians to asynchronous, synchronous, and blended coursework. Maybe that's probably what future librarians have experienced in this past year. Perhaps most importantly, students should have that opportunity to apply their knowledge practically as a teacher across these environments. And ideally, this would be in some sort of practical or cooperative placement, but opportunities for practice also exist as coursework instructing peers. So you can read all about it here. Thank you so much for having me.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for having me here. It is quite an honor to be speaking even briefly at the 2021 eLearning Symposium. I work at the Roberts and Davies Library, which is a very small rare book library within Massey College at the University of Toronto. Now, Massey College is a residential college, and going all the way back to its history, along the way, it started to collect a lot of printing presses, Vandercook's, Imperial Press, Washington Press, and slowly it morphed into this little workshop where people would come into the bibliography room and begin to print the old-fashioned way, Gutenberg style. In 2000, the University of Toronto started a new collaborative graduate program called Book History and Print Culture, and this program got usurped by this library at Massey College. So it serves a dual role, both as a residential college library, but also as the foundation for this collaborative program focusing entirely on printing history. So we were presented with a very unique challenge when COVID hit and we had to move things online. Not only are we not a circulating library or host, you know, one-on-one interviews or had the potential to capture webinars or interactions with other people, we were in this very unique place where we had items that many people didn't even know we had, and at the same time, the majority of our work relied on people coming in person and working with the items that we have in the library and actually creating some of their own materials using the printing presses. So we decided to begin by starting a YouTube channel. Now, I know YouTube is not very revolutionary or new at this time in history, as many people have already started so many. However, we wanted to imitate or simulate the experience of being in the bibliography room. We wanted students to feel like they're coming down the stairs and seeing things for the first time. And their eyes are slowly wandering around the room and they notice certain things. On the e-learning spectrum, YouTube kind of finds itself in this weird hybrid of both an interactive webinar, since viewers have the opportunity to ask questions in the comment section, and at the same time, it's both a social media platform and in many ways, especially for libraries, it exists as an outreach program. So in our very first three videos, we tried to replicate the tour experience and to show people how to use the printing presses we have. At the time, the college printer also had his own little printing press at home, and our lead printer, Stephen Sword, is also a printing historian, and he had his own little print shop in his own basement. So everyone kind of took their own little corner of their specialization and began to film videos demonstrating how to use these printing presses. We wanted to show students composition, imposition, and the entirety of press work. It was very important for students to understand how a book is made, how paper is made, how you have to take into consideration the sizing of the paper before you begin to work on the formatting and actual type work for your final product. But the second thing I wanted to reproduce was that experience of stumbling into the library and just picking a random book off the shelf and not knowing anything about it. And I took the opportunity that I had at the time, which was me being introduced into this library space, to say, hey, let's look at this library together, both of us with fresh new eyes, as if we've never been here before. So I randomly started picking books off the shelf, and in each weekly video, I try to pick a random book off the shelf that catches my eye just simply because of the way it looks or because of the way it's its spine happens to be falling apart. And I'll do a little bit of research and look into the background of this book. And sometimes it really connects to the history of the college, which creates kind of a little bit of local folklore. For example, I found a first edition of Little Dorrit. And what was fascinating about this piece of artwork was that it used to belong to Robertson Davies himself, and it was given to him by the students at the time. And later it got sold, bought again, and given to a subsequent principal of the college years later. And then he donated to the library. Within this box, we not only have the first editions of Charles Dickens, where students can see advertisements from the 1800s and have a more visual experience of what the publication history of a Charles Dickens work used to look like, but they also get to see the cards that are signed by other students. And in this process, not only have I personally learned a lot about each individual item, but we had the opportunity to connect both its history and the social sphere to the college itself, and create more of a story around each item. And the randomness with which I've picked them off the shelf kind of simulates that experience of just wandering through the stacks, not knowing what you might find. In the spirit of the casual encounter with a book, I also wanted for people to have the experience of the exhibit cases. When you walk into a library, you'll often see various exhibition cases having a curated display. And the first time I wanted to show people how one of these is planned out, and this was for the Halloween kind of spooky, some creepy books from our collection, especially ones with cool illustrations that were done in woodcuts. And I wanted to show people the experience of planning out an exhibition. And then afterwards, we decided to use YouTube Shorts because the shorts would be quick and to the point, but it would give them that quick glimpse when you're just walking through a library and getting a moment to glance at some of the exhibition cases. And we recently did this with the Pride exhibit, which was in honor of the high table we were going to have at the college called Celebrating Pride. Now, this project is very time demanding as it requires us as a team to work a lot on the back end and edit videos, do all the research, collect all of the things necessary in order to present a polished final product. But it's also given us the opportunity to include students and faculty in a collaborative project. So for example, we had a student who works in the printing room as an apprentice who is from the German department at the University of Toronto. And we happen to have a book from the 1600s on printing history that's in German. And this student comes in often and looks and explores this book in detail. So we decided to create a video where we include our printing apprentice, and he would get the chance to showcase his experience with this one item. And this video alone created some stronger bonds with various departments on campus, but it's also included student activity. Additionally, there's also the possibility of digitization where it comes to rare books. And we've had some digitized items or some projects taken here and there for medieval manuscripts in our collection or extremely rare books. And then students took it upon themselves to curate a specific exhibition online using the Omeka platform. And this way they got to add annotations, captions, metadata of all kinds, and create their own little curated exhibit, which was also a very nice way to do both outreach and connect to students, but make use of our rare book collection. Unfortunately, there are two downsides to this experience, which cannot be captured on any kind of digitized format. And that's the fact that when you work with rare books, the first thing is the aura around the experience of actually seeing a rare book in front of you, to know that what you're holding is a genuine medieval manuscript. It simply cannot be mass-produced, and they are a very unique artifact. And that is something that cannot be duplicated or replicated even within the most intense forms of digitization, 3D printing, or whatever other levels you take these to. So that's just something that is a missing component. And it's unfortunately also one of the highlights of entering a rare book library. Now, the second one is the workshop component in the bibliography room. A very big part of the bib room is the fact that students can walk in and do it themselves, to actually take type from the cases, put it in the composing stick, create the form themselves, and actually be involved in the time-consuming process of printing. While they can watch it in a very documentary style format on our channel, it will never be the same as them actually having done it themselves, and they don't get the satisfaction at the end to say that I have printed this item from scratch myself. Thank you all very much for watching, and I look forward to talking to you at the symposium. Bye!
Hi everyone, thanks so much for tuning in today. My name is Graham Lavender and I am the Associate Librarian at the Michener Institute in Toronto. And I'm really excited to talk to you today about a project I've been working on. It's called Finding Evidence-Based Information for Health Sciences Students, and it is a series of open licensed information literacy modules for colleges and other institutions across Ontario. So before I get started, I want to give a big shout out to the steering committee. You'll see their names in the bottom left corner of the screen. So why don't we go ahead and dive right in? The first thing you need to know is that this was a big, big project with a lot of people involved. There were 14 Ontario College libraries that collaborated, in addition to the Michener Institute, the Learning Portal, and College Libraries Ontario. Let me give you some background on how this whole project got started. Colleges have been delivering Bachelor of Nursing programs in partnership with universities for many years now, where students do 2 years at the college and then 2 years at the university. But now, many colleges are starting to deliver the full degree on their own, so college libraries will be responsible for supporting students at a higher level. In addition, many college libraries find it challenging to secure in-class time to provide information literacy instruction to students, so they'd like to offer asynchronous learning objects to supplement in-person instruction. Since various college libraries were experiencing these same challenges, it made sense for several library leaders to group together and create a grant proposal. The funding came through eCampus Ontario's Virtual Learning Strategy, which has distributed $50 million for virtual learning projects across the province. Through the VLS funding, they were able to hire me as a secondment from Michener. My role is officially Health Science Librarian Lead, and I'm responsible for the content of the modules. VLS also provided our project with funding for instructional design and multimedia development from the Learning Portal team. If you're not familiar with the Learning Portal, it's a collaboration between College Libraries Ontario, several Ontario College Learning Centres, and the Ontario College Library Service, OCLS, with some original content developed by the Learning Portal team and some content donated in kind by the colleges. It includes modules for students on a variety of skills, from research to writing, math, and more. Our new modules will become part of the Learning Portal, which is built on the LibGuides platform, and there will also be a version released as a pressbook. As I mentioned, there are 14 college libraries plus the Michener Institute collaborating on this project. So if you're picturing more than a dozen individuals making time in their schedules for a weekly 3-hour working meeting to hash out all the details as a group, you'll be relieved to know that this is not our approach at all. Instead, I've been given responsibility for developing the content of the modules in consultation with the collaborators. We do feel it's important to bring everyone together occasionally, but so far we've only done this 3 times, and we'll do it once more in January before the project wraps up at the end of February. In between these big meetings, I've had individual meetings with representatives from each of the collaborating libraries. This has been a great way for me to make sure I'm considering the unique needs of each institution and to make sure every voice is heard. Working remotely has been an interesting experience. Remote work was the obvious choice for this project, regardless of the pandemic, considering the physical distance between the various collaborators. This aspect of things went very smoothly, though I imagine it would have been more challenging even just a few years ago, before so many of us became comfortable with remote work. For each of the 12 modules, I've had one of the collaborators serve as a reviewer, and this process has led to significant improvements in the content. Additionally, I conducted consultations with faculty from as many institutions as possible to make sure that the content of the modules is well matched with course curriculum. Besides generating useful feedback from faculty that I used to improve the modules, I also saw the consultations as an opportunity to raise awareness about the project. It was encouraging to see how enthusiastic the faculty were about this new tool. Open licenses play a key role in this project, both in creating the content and in publishing the finished product. Although some of the modules were created mostly from scratch, we saved some time by adapting existing content in many cases. So we appreciate the many librarians and other creators who have been licensing their work under an open license. The learning portal is already published under a Creative Commons license, and in fact, using an open license is a requirement from eCampus Ontario. The modules will be licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial license and an Ontario Commons license. The ACRL framework is a standard information literacy tool in academic libraries, and many librarians make use of it in their instruction work. So early in the project, the question came up as to whether we should try to somehow integrate it into the modules. My initial thought was that non-librarian faculty would likely not be familiar with it and therefore not care about it. However, someone raised the point that while faculty may not know about ACRL or the framework, the idea of aligning curriculum with some kind of external guidelines that are acknowledged across institutions would resonate. One option would be to make specific reference to the six frames of the framework within the modules, but we came up with an approach that will allow interested library instructors to follow the framework while others don't have to worry about it. I'm currently developing a document that will accompany the modules, and in this document, I will map the modules to the six frames. At this point, the core content for the modules has been finalized and the Learning Portal team is hard at work bringing it all to life. Based on the content I've curated and created, our multimedia developers have been creating videos and activities to make the modules more engaging. We're using H5P for the quizzes and other interactive elements. The finished product will be available in March 2022. So here you can see a little preview of what this is going to look like. So you can see the headings, the sections that we've divided it into: prepare to search, start to search, evaluate your evidence, write an academic paper, cite your sources. And then we also have a glossary of the terms that we'll be using so that if students later, after they've gone through the modules, they're thinking, oh, right, I need to remember what a peer-reviewed journal is. They won't have to dig through the modules to find that out. They can go straight to the glossary. So here's a snapshot of the module on developing your topic. You can see on the left side, we have some tips. And on the right side, this is the core part of the content. It's been divided into tabs. So you can see there's a section on developing your topic, turning your topic into a question, refining your question, using PICO and concept mapping techniques. And then there's also a tab on testing your knowledge. And you can see at the bottom, there's a video embedded here. And this is one of the awesome, awesome videos that the Learning Portal team has developed for us. So here we are inside another module. This one is about choosing a search interface. And you can see on the left side, there's a list of the colleges and students can click on their college and it will take them to a list of databases available at that college. On the right side, of course, here's the main content, information about finding journal articles, drug information, gray literature, etc. And then at the bottom, we have a little embedded quiz so students can check whether they've understood things. And this is one of the interactive elements that's been developed using H5P. Unfortunately, I can't send you the full content as it exists now because it's very much in a draft form. But if you're interested to take a peek, what I would suggest you do is check out the learning portal. So I've got the URL for you right here. But if you take a look through the learning portal, you'll get a very, very good sense of what these modules will look like when they're completed. And of course, if you bookmark this page, you can come back once we've launched. So the launch will be in March of this coming year, and we will be widely promoting it. So watch out for a notification around that time. Thanks so much for listening, everyone. If you want to get in touch, feel free to reach out to me on Twitter or by email. I'm always happy to chat about this project. So, take care.